Hymn 98, Jesus, I Will Ponder Now. Jesus, I will ponder now on your holy passion. With your Spirit me endow for such meditation. Grant that I in love and faith may cherish of your suffering, pain, and death, that I may not perish. Make me see your great distress, anguish, and affliction, bounds and stripes and wretchedness and your crucifixion. Make me see how scourge and rod, spear and nails did wound you, how for them you died, O God, who with thorns had crowned. Yet, O Lord, not thus alone, make me see your passion, but its cause to me make known, and its termination. I also and my sin wrought your deep affliction. This indeed the cause has been of your crucifixion. If my sins give me alarm and my conscience grieve me, let your cross my fear disarm, peace of conscience give me, help me see forgiveness won by your holy passion. If for me he slays his son, God must have compassion. Two more.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's all right.
In my copy.
Don't worry about it. Grant that I your passion view with repentant grieving. Let me not bring shame to you by unholy living. How could I refuse to shun every sinful pleasure, since for me God's only Son suffered without measure. Graciously my faith renew, help me bear. give you love for love. Hear me, O my Savior, that I may in heaven above sing your praise forever.
Please rise for the altar service. This is what the Lord Jesus Christ says. I know your deeds. You have a reputation for being alive, but you are dead. Wake up, strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I have not found your deeds complete in the sight of my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Obey it and repent. Turn to me and be saved, for the fear of the Lord is the key to this treasure. Lord our God, Heavenly Father, give attention to your servant's prayer and our plea for mercy. Hear the cry that your servants raise in your presence. Grant the supplication of your servants who trust in your Son. Hear from heaven your dwelling place, and when you hear, forgive. Please join me in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, our Father, remember not our sins. Remember your mercy revealed in your plan to forgive us. Remember your grace revealed in your Son's sacrifice to save us. Remember your peace revealed by the Holy Spirit in the gospel, your power for the salvation of all who believe. Forgive our sins. Speak to our hearts. Enable us to put aside guilt and shame, and dispel our sorrows with the comfort of your word. Satisfy us with the knowledge that we have everlasting life through Jesus Christ, the Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. In Jesus, you have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace. Therefore, love the Lord, all his saints. We give thanks to you, O God. We give thanks for the blessing of your eternal grace and for your mercy that endures forever. As we hear about your wonderful works, bless us with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Amen. Please be seated for 104, verse 1. Go to Dark Gethsemane. Tonight, the compilation of the four Gospels takes us to Gethsemane. Then Jesus told them, "This very night you will all fall away on account of me, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee." Peter replied, "Even if all fall away on account of you, I never will." "I tell you the truth," Jesus answered, "this very night, before the rooster crows twice, you will disown me three times." But Peter declared, "Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you." And all the other disciples said the same. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here. Keep watch with me." Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will." An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. And then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Could you not keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak." He went away a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour is near when the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." Now Judas, who betrayed him, knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. "The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him." Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss? Friend, do what you came for." When Jesus' followers saw what was going to happen, they said, "Lord, shall we strike with our swords?" And Peter struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his right ear. That servant's name was Malchus. But Jesus answered, "No more of this." And he touched the man's ear and healed him. "Put your sword back in its place," Jesus said. "For all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you think I cannot call on my Father, and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels, 72,000. But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen in this way? Jesus, knowing all that was going to happen to him, went out and asked them, "Who is it you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "I am he," Jesus said. And Judas the traitor was standing there with them. When Jesus said, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Who is it you want?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." "I told you that I am he," Jesus answered. "If you are looking for me, then let these men go." This happened so that the words he had spoken would be fulfilled, "I have not lost one of those you gave me." The men seized Jesus and arrested him. "Am I leading a rebellion," said Jesus, "that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I was with you teaching in the temple courts, and you did not arrest me then." But the scriptures must be fulfilled. Then all the disciples deserted him and fled. A young man, wearing nothing but a linen garment, was following Jesus. When they seized him, he fled naked, leaving his garment behind in their hands. This is Jesus as he was in Gethsemane. Please join me now in hymn 106. "Come to Calvary's Holy Mountain."
Come to Calvary's holy mountain, sinners ruined by the fall. Here a pure and healing fountain flows to you, to me, to all. In a full perpetual tide, open when our Savior died. guilty free remission, here the troubled peace may find. Health this fountain will restore, he that drinks shall thirst no more. He that drinks shall live forever, 'tis a soul-renewing flood. God is faithful, God will never break his covenant of blood. Signed when our Redeemer died, sealed when he was crucified.
The word for this evening's meditation, Luke 23:32-34. This is what we read there. Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with Jesus to be executed. When they came to the place called Skull, there they crucified him along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." This is God's word. We bow our heads in prayer. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts now be acceptable in your sight. You are our strength. You are our Redeemer. Amen. Dear friends of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, I came across a website just a few days ago, and it was called The 48 Laws of Power. The goal of the site was to ensure that in any given situation in life, the person who knew and followed these rules would always have the upper hand. Studying this scripture text reminded me of law number 19, and I quote, "Know who you are dealing with. Do not offend the wrong person." The law offered suggestions on how to behave in order to avoid such an offense. Suggestion number 5, swallow the impulse to offend, even if the other person seems weak. The satisfaction is meager compared to the danger that someday he or she will be in a position to hurt you. Several people who participated in Jesus' trial and his sufferings and crucifixion might have benefited from knowing that law number 19 and suggestion number 5. Because Jesus tried to help them understand who they were dealing with and the danger of underestimating who he was and who he represented. He told his disciples, and it is likely that members of the mob overheard this, "Do you think I cannot call on my Father and he will at once put at my disposal more than 72,000 angels? Jesus is the commander-in-chief of the heavenly hosts, of the armies of heaven." He was trying to tell them who they were dealing with. At his trial, before the Sanhedrin, the elders, the chief priests, the Pharisees, the ruling council in Jerusalem, Jesus told all those teachers of the law and all those elders of the people who sought to condemn him, quote, "But I say to all of you, in the future you will see me sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." He was trying to inform them that he is the one who will judge every human being, including them. He was trying to tell them who he was, who he represented, who they were dealing with. To the larger number of people who followed him to Calvary, especially to the women who were mourning, wailing as they followed him through the Via Dolorosa, the road of sorrows, he said, "Do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves and for your children, for the time will come when you will say, 'Blessed are the barren women and the wombs that never bore and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if men do these things when the tree is green, for no good reason, what will they do when it is dry, when Israel rebelled against Rome?" God will place all things under Jesus' feet after his resurrection. And he was trying to inform them who they were dealing with, who he represented, that someday God would permit Roman's armed forces to devastate Jerusalem, raise the temple to the ground and slaughter many of its inhabitants. If you'll allow this play on words, pompous Pilate, arrogant governor of that province, said to Jesus, "Don't you realize I have power either to free you or crucify you?" Jesus answered, "You would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above." Jesus knew that Pilate was the pawn of Rome and easily played by the Jews. Jesus also knew that Pilate had no idea who he was dealing with and whom Jesus represented, God's own Son, the Son of our Father in heaven. And Jesus followed that declaration with this one. "Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." A greater sin. Was it the sin of the mob who arrested Jesus under cover of darkness, rather than in the broad daylight when he was in and about the temple courts? Was it the sin of the Sanhedrin, that Jewish ruling council? They knew about Jesus' miracles. They had witnessed Jesus' miracles. They couldn't refute his miracles, nor could they find anything to convict him of. They couldn't convict him of any sin. They thought they could silence Jesus with the condemnation that evolved from their own self-righteousness. They held a kangaroo court, and they condemned him. Was that the greater sin? They should have known better. What about the sin of the crowd that followed him? Some of those same people that welcomed him in his triumphant entry into Jerusalem when he came in on the foal of a donkey. "Hallelujah, hallelujah, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And then they called for his crucifixion, and now they're following him to that execution. Those who praised his entry at one point were not willing to raise a single finger to prevent his execution at this point. Yeah, I got it. I know who you're thinking of. Maybe the one who committed the greater sin was Judas. Judas, who walked and talked with him for 3.5 years. Judas, who witnessed the miracles. Judas, called to be one of the 12 by Jesus himself, and he betrays Jesus into the hands of those who were going to execute him? He later had to admit to himself that he had betrayed innocent blood, and that led to his suicide. Now, Jesus had several times during his ministry tried to warn Judas what his flaw was, who Jesus was, who he represented. He tried to inform him, understand who it is you're dealing with. Judas didn't buy into that. So now here's the thing. It would be easy for you and I to condemn each and every one of these individuals or groups, wouldn't it? Huh? Despite what they had seen and heard, despite that, all of them thought Jesus was no more than a religious fanatic or a common man with no real power, no real authority, could ever cause them any distress. They were without excuse, because they didn't believe him when he told them the truth. They didn't regard him when he performed those miracles. They didn't humble themselves when they realized they couldn't find anything to condemn him for. He tried to tell them who they were dealing with. He tried to tell them who he represented, and no one listened. Now, what did those soldiers think? You know, the key focus of our text. While his blood ran from his wounds and dripped down at their place on Calvary, from the nails they had pounded into his hands and feet, while he gasped for breath as life was being squeezed out of him by this execution, what were they doing? They were casting lots for his clothing. After all, he's never going to have to worry about clothing anymore. We could condemn them too, couldn't we? Yeah, we could use that common phrase. Ignorance is no excuse. But Jesus knew that they did not know who they were dealing with, not really. So he offered up a prayer to the one he represented, who he always said he was one with. He said, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. They don't know who they're dealing with. They don't know that I have power." They didn't understand rule number 19 or subset number 5. But then there is this statement by the prophet Isaiah, and listen carefully. Surely he took up our infirmities, carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by God, and afflicted by God, but he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all. Paul summarized that statement this way: Jesus was delivered over to death for our sins. So now, let's rethink that phrase for just a moment. He who handed me over to you, is guilty of the greater sin. The mob didn't know who they were dealing with. The Sanhedrin certainly didn't believe Jesus was the Son of God. Pilate didn't recognize the truth when it was staring him right in the face. The crowd following him to the cross, the death of their hopes for another imperial Israel. All of them, like the soldiers, really didn't have a clue who they were dealing with, or they might have understood rule number 19, subset 5, without even knowing about it. Don't mess with someone who can hurt you later on. But you and I, we do know, don't we? We know who we're dealing with, don't we? Isn't that why you are sitting here in these pews this evening? Because you know and believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. You have come here to worship him. Isn't it our mouths we use to confess our own sins and pray for forgiveness here this evening? Isn't it our hearts that receive the absolution with joy and move forward from this place without guilt or shame burdening us? Isn't it our lips that sing praise to him, that say prayers to him, that acknowledge that on the last day he will return with his angels to judge the living and the dead? Isn't we are the ones who know our sins are forgiven, our souls are saved. We know Jesus is the judge. I could ask you those in question form and each and every one of you would answer, yes, I know who I am dealing with. I know who he represents. Do we? Do we really recognize who we're dealing with when we tend to shrug off what we consider to be lesser sins? When we continue in sins of habit or sins of choice that have become, so much a part of us that we don't even realize sometimes we're committing them, do we really think we know who we are dealing with? When our vulgar words, or drunken stupors, or sexual immorality, or grudges, or whatever it is, show a disregard for the presence of a holy God who punishes sin, who hears every word, sees every action, knows our very thoughts, do we really understand who it is we are dealing with, who he represents, and the power he has to hurt us? When we conform our lives to society's standards, to our peer group rather than God's, when we give in to the whims of our peers, when we focus more on living to gratify ourselves and to please God, are we forgetting the Lord who said, I will wipe mankind whom I have created from the face of the earth, the flood? The Lord who rained down burning sulfur on Sodom and Gomorrah? The Lord who so cauterized that festering wound of moral depravity that no civilization could occupy that territory since that time? The Lord who rebuked Pharaoh with 10 plagues and in one of them took his own son? The Lord who caused Israel to wander for 40 years in the wilderness said, no one who has ever treated me with contempt will ever see the promised land. Do we really understand who it is we are dealing with? Who he represents? We need to remember that all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to Jesus. That one day we confess that he will return to judge the living and the dead. He will judge the sins of choice and the sins of habit. He will judge the outright lies. He will judge the hidden faults. He will judge the bitterness, the vengeful attitude, all sins from the heinous, vicious, and brutal to the trivial, mischievous, and whimsical. On that day, he will have the power to judge the things we should not have done, to judge the things that we left undone that we should have, and publicly, formally, and finally will declare forgiven. Forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Still have a sinful nature. We struggle with it day in and day out. Sometimes we don't even recognize that it is a struggle because too often we give into it without even thinking about what we're doing. And every time, every single time, Jesus is interceding for us at the right hand of God the Father and saying, Father, forgive them. Not just the soldiers, not just the crowd, not just the Sanhedrin. Forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. They don't know who they're dealing with. They don't always remember the life, the death, the resurrection. You see, my friends, focus on this. That was the longing in Jesus' heart for every single human being that ever lived, to see all sins recognized, yes, so that all sinners could see in him their Savior, the forgiveness of their sins. It was what moved him to allow the mob to arrest him. It was what moved him to allow the Sanhedrin to condemn an innocent man. It was what moved him to allow Pilate to commit him to the cross. It was what moved him to allow the crowd who followed to save themselves rather than try to rebel against that execution. It was him longing to forgive everyone. Look down at those soldiers who had just bloodied his hands and feet, maybe even participated in the scourging that tore his back to shreds, were preoccupied with casting lots for his clothing, who looked down at them and not just thinking about those men gathered there, but everyone who would ever gather anywhere in this world. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. They did not realize Rule 19, Subsection 5, swallow the impulse to offend, we'll add Jesus Christ. Even if Jesus Christ seems weak to you, as some people often view him, he's not doing what I want him to do. He's not doing what I think he should be doing in this world. The satisfaction of denigrating Jesus at any point in our life should never be compared to the danger that someday he will be in a position to hurt us. For all those who offended God before they didn't even know he existed, for all those who offend God because they think he will overlook their sins for the sake of their good deeds, for all those who think that remorse is sufficient but do not realize that all their tears cannot wash away one single sin, Jesus' prayer is for all of those. For his name's sake, Father accepts that his blood washes away all your sins. For his name's sake, even those who do not know what they are doing today may come to the realization of who they are dealing with tomorrow, and by that same person who they offended in the past will be forgiven in the present, and they can look forward to a future of glory with him. The one who is guilty of the greater sin is everyone who hears this prayer and takes it to heart personally. Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing. Because in that prayer, there is an intercession for soldiers, and for you, and for me. For us whose sins made that piercing necessary, thank God that you do know who you are dealing with, that you do know that sin is contrary to the will of God, that you do know that God condemns sin, that you do know that for his son's sake, God forgives the sinner. So this evening, leave here praising him for his willingness to plead your case before his Father's throne, even at those times when you do not realize who you are dealing with. And the fail to realize that may lead you into sin. For it is his willingness, his desire, and he proved it by dying for us, that he wants you to know you are forgiven and to live as one forgiven and to forget all about all the other rules that anybody may make up or come think of in dealing with the world around you. You will remain ruled by Jesus Christ. Amen. Now may that peace which surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and your minds in Christ unto life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for our offering. Please rise for our closing prayer. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, precious Savior, you were faithful to your Father and to me, even to the point of death. By focusing on your suffering and death for me, graciously grant not only that I view my sins with repentant grieving, but also that I focus on your holy, precious blood that cleanses me from all sin. Through the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit, through the word I have heard, lead me to love you more by living in obedience to your commandments and by holding on to your teachings. Day after day, continue to draw me to that cross which is blessed with healing gifts for souls distressed, that I may not only be at peace with God, but also seek to be at peace with all people. I thank you also, my Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously kept me safe throughout this day. As your child, I implore you to graciously keep me throughout the coming night. Into your hands I commend myself and all those I love. Send your holy angels to be with us, that the wicked foe may have no power over us. Amen. Dear friends of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, receive with believing hearts the blessing of your Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon each of you with his favor and always give to each and every one of you his peace. Amen. 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 Please be seated for our closing hymn, 587.